All right, and we back on the forecast. So, colorism in the black community. I definitely agree it's a huge problem on a whole lot of different fronts. Of course, with the light-skinned women and the dark-skinned women. But the fact that it even goes for men, you have the era of the dark-skinned men, where the dark-skinned men is in, and then the era of the light-skinned men, where the light-skinned men is in. And people even brought it up during the whole NBA Finals about colorism with Steph Curry and LeBron James. Colorism is definitely a huge issue in the community. And again, it's nothing but another part of Stockholm Syndrome. It's something that was beaten into our mind frames. And we're still psychologically affected after hundreds of years and still continuing today. And it's definitely a tricky subject because when you look at the history of colorism, it stems from slavery, of course, where a white man got a black woman pregnant, most times through rape, by the way. The kid she would give birth to would still be the slave owner's son. So, of course, he would be treated differently from the other slaves, and he was a part white. Now, the problem for them is the people who created racism in the first place said, if you had one drop of black in you, you are black. Because they even realized, damn, that black DNA is a motherfucker. It just takes over everything. Now, for hundreds of years, we see the light-skinned black men get treated better than the dark-skinned black men, or the light-skinned black woman get treated better than the light-skinned black woman, better than they ever have. But the whole time, we never realized that they were still slaves, just like we were still slaves. The law says if the mother is a slave, then the child would also be born as a slave. And so if the mother was a black woman, because that was supposed to be the case, even though there were plenty of cases where, you know, the white woman would rape the black man, believe it or not, they have always used this false allegation over our heads for a long time now. But what the darker skinned people didn't really realize is the lighter skinned people also was not accepted by the darker skinned people or the white people. They always have had their own problems. But at the end of the day, when it comes down to American society, we are all in the same boat. And the one problem with our people is we have never been able to get over our tribalism. And the divide and conquer thing is the only thing really keeping us divided and conquered. Now, again, the people who don't identify with you, they won't identify with you. You don't have to worry about them. And if we are sticking to our principles and doing what we're supposed to do, then there's no way they can stop it from happening. There's no way anyone can stop it from happening. Now, it's just my opinion, but I think instead of talking about light skin, dark skin, men versus women, coon or not, sellout or not, we should be talking about building a society, building a economy, talking about this delegation we could put together to fund black businesses, talking about how we can build our black schools and how we can fund the education system, paying the teachers, buying the books, going out, patrolling our own communities, becoming the policy makers in our own area, becoming the DA, becoming the judges, becoming the lawyers, and sticking up for the ones that stick up for our people. We could be talking about all of these issues instead of the things that divide us. There are plenty of things that bring us together. There are more things that bring us together than that divide us. But for whatever reason, we go for the things that divide us. That's just a human thing. Most people go for the things that divide them. But instead of focusing on the people who are against us or being against ourselves, we should be focusing on building something, a system that can combat the system that we are currently in. And we can easily do these things right now. And, you know, it's not rocket science. We don't have to read, like, rocket science books or anything. It's just a matter of focusing on the issues that's right in front of our face. The same thing that we're all saying. The things that we all agreeing on. But we're all just disagreeing on things that were socially engineered in the first place, wasting our time. And at this point, we have to spend so much time building each other up that we don't have time to bring down anybody else. So I want to hear what you got to say. I want to hear about your experience with colorism from the dark skin perspective, from the light skin perspective.
Most of that time from 1619 to 1965, we had no basic rights in this country. Forget beauty. We weren't even considered people in the eyes of the law, nor in the eyes of our neighbors in the country and in the world. And so beauty is just a small piece of a much bigger animal. And until we understand that much bigger animal, we'll never understand the issue of colorism. What has happened over time, across generations, is an internalization of the degradation of what it means to be black in the world. Because this is not just a U.S. phenomenon. Go to Ghana today, go to Senegal today, go to the Gambia today, go to South Africa today, and you will see billboards promoting skin bleaching cream, even in the face of knowing that it causes cancer. Our sisters are trying to lighten themselves in response to an internalized racism that is global. My favorite African proverb is, until the lion has a historian, the hunter will always be a hero. Unless we are able to understand and articulate the issue from multiple points of view, including from the point of view of those who are the recipients or on the receiving end of this oppressive, degrading image that has been created over generations for black people, we're only going to continue to perpetuate the stereotypes.
All right, and everybody's buzzing about it on Twitter, so I gotta ask, whatever. It's like, you like black, you said you like black girls, but you said it's just like.
I answered this question earlier, you know?
Yeah.
I don't feel like I have a need to simplify it again, but I'm gonna simplify it again.
Okay,
you know, I carry myself like I'm an average dude because I don't see myself no better than him, no better than him, you know, or no less than him. So if he could say that he likes skinny women, if he prefers skinny women more than a more chubby or heavy set women, he could say that and nobody won't get mad at him. I just said I don't like women with my complexion. I like light-skinned women. I want you to be lighter than me. I love African-American women, but I just don't like my skin complexion.
Okay. Well, I like your skin complexion.
We too gutter. Black people, my complexion, we too gutter. Light-skinned women, they more sensitive, you know?
There's some dark-skinned women out here sensitive.
No, they too tough. They too tough. Light-skinned women, we could break them down more easy, you know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Yeah. That's it.
Local judge has pleaded guilty to ethics violations, but the question at the heart of his controversy is still unanswered. Jefferson Circuit Court Judge Olu Stevens received a 90-day suspension in exchange for pleading guilty to 7 counts. WLKY's Mark Vanderhoff has been following this case and investigating. Joins us live in the newsroom now. Mark, were we expecting this plea deal?
No, Jennifer, a trial was set to begin today in Louisville in front of the State Judicial Ethics Commission. That could have gone on for 2 or 3 days. Instead, the plea deal was announced and everything was over in 10 or 15 minutes. Judge Olu Stevens pleaded guilty to 7 of 8 ethics violations. He will immediately begin serving the 90-day unpaid suspension. Stevens violated judicial ethics by criticizing prosecutors and others on social media and in public comments. He was upset the Commonwealth's attorney challenged his right to dismiss a jury based on racial makeup. In court, Stevens apologized for his comments and recognized the Commonwealth's attorney's right to seek clarification. He spoke to reporters very briefly before leaving.
I just want to, first of all, thank everyone that's come out to support me today. I want to say that I'm delighted to have this over with, move forward, and I'm looking forward to getting back to the bench.
Now, Commonwealth's attorney Tom Wine issued a statement that read, in part, I accept Judge Stevens' apology. I have had no personal animosity towards Judge Stevens, and I have had and I have none now. Now, Wine's legal challenge on Stevens' ruling that dismissed a jury is awaiting an opinion from the Supreme Court.
We have an ABC News exclusive in the story of Rachel Dolezal, the NAACP leader now accused of lying about being black, her own parents coming out and saying their daughter is, in fact, white.
And now her two adopted brothers are speaking out, offering their take on the sister and the secret that she asked them to keep. ABC's Kendis Gibson is in Spokane, Washington for us this morning. Hi, Kendis.
Hi, Paula. Hi, Dan. And I got to tell you, the more we talk with people in this small town of about 200,000, the more we get a sense that people feel duped by the head of the local NAACP. In the meantime, the person at the center of this controversy, the root of it all, isn't speaking out. This morning, the adopted brothers of Spokane NAACP leader Rachel Dolezal speaking out for the first time about the controversy surrounding her racial identity.
She took me aside and told me to make sure that no one found out where she was actually from and that she was going to change her identity, and for me not to blow her cover.
The most talked about
NAACP
an uproar. Dolezal making national headlines after this interview went viral.
Are your parents, are they white?
The civil rights activist and Africana studies professor accused of lying about her race, marking black on a City of Spokane volunteer job application.
She had the best intentions and she did some good, but she did not go about it in the right way. She was grew up white and she was really privileged growing up.
This photo of Dolezal sporting long dreadlocks extensions at an MLK rally in January, appearing different from the blonde girl born in Montana seen in these photos released by her parents. Dolezal's brother saying Rachel's physical transformation started a few years ago.
It started out with the hair, and then she'd have, you know, probably a little darker tan. And it was very progressive.
Dolezal emailing NAACP chapter members over the weekend, writing, there are many layers to this situation. Her credibility on the docket Monday when the NAACP board meets. Dolezal's predecessor as chapter president telling me he had no idea Dolezal might be white.
You had no idea your successor was white.
Right. It just didn't matter with me, really. So she said, I went by what she said.
And what did she say?
She said African-American.
And everybody believed it. In the meantime, Dolezal in that email to many of the members saying that she will discuss her race tomorrow here in that meeting with the board members in Spokane.